Verse for opening a sutra. The answer past profound and wonderful Dharma is difficult to encounter in hundreds of millions of aeons. I now see and hear it, receive and uphold it, and I vow to fathom the Tathagata's true meaning. The Wonderful Dharma, Lotus Flower Sutra. Chapter 14. Happily Dwelling Conduct. At that time, Dharma Prince Manjusri Bodhisattva Mahasattva said to the Buddha, "World-honored one, all these bodhisattvas are extremely rare, reverently complying with the Buddha. They have made great vows to protect, maintain, read, and speak this Dharma Flower Sutra in the future evil age. World-honored one, how should bodhisattvas, mahasattvas, speak this sutra in the future evil age?" The Buddha told Manjusri, "If a bodhisattva mahasattva wishes to speak this sutra in the future evil age, he should dwell securely in four dharmas. First, by dwelling in the bodhisattva's range of practice and the bodhisattva's range of association, he'll be able to expound this sutra for living beings." Manjusri, what is meant by the bodhisattva mahasattva's range of practice? If a bodhisattva mahasattva dwells on the ground of patience, is gentle and compliant, not impetuous or volatile, if his mind is not frightened, if moreover he does not practice in regard to any dharma, but contemplates the marks of all dharmas as they really are, not, however, practicing non-discrimination, that is called the Bodhisattva Mahasattva's range of practice. What is meant by the Bodhisattva Mahasattva's range of association? Bodhisattvas Mahasattvas do not draw near to kings, princes, great ministers, or officials. They do not draw near to externalists, brahmacharins, nigrantas, and the like, or to writers of worldly literature, to those who sing praises of externalist writings, to lokayatas or to the opponents of lokayatas. They also do not draw near to violent amusements such as boxing and wrestling, to displays of martial arts that involve mutual attack, to natas or to any entertainment that uses magic. They do not draw near to chandalas, to those who raise pigs, sheep, chickens or dogs, or to those who hunt, fish, trap, or engage in any other evil activities. If such people should, on occasion, come to them, they speak the Dharma for them, but they have no expectations. They also do not draw near to those who seek to be hearers, whether bhikshus, bhikshunis, upasakas, or upasikas, and they do not make a half bow to them. They do not remain in a room, a promenade, or a lecture hall with them. Should such people sometimes come to them, they speak Dharma as is appropriate, but seek nothing in return. Manjusri, moreover, bodhisattvas, mahasattvas, must not regard women's bodies as objects of desire and speak Dharma for them. They do not take delight in looking at women. If they enter the homes of others, they do not speak with young girls, maidens, widows, and so forth. Further, they do not draw near to the five kinds of unmanly men or become friends with them. They do not enter others' houses alone. If for some reason they must enter alone, they single-mindedly recollect the Buddha. If they speak the Dharma for women, they do not smile or laugh and let their teeth show, nor do they expose their chests. Even for the sake of the Dharma, they do not become familiar with them, much less for the sake of other matters. They take no delight in raising young disciples, shramaneras, or children, and they do not take pleasure in sharing the same master with them. They always delight and sitting in dhyana, and in a quiet place cultivating, collecting their thoughts, manjushri. This is called the first range of association. Further, bodhisattvas, mahasattvas, contemplate all dharmas as empty, as characterized by actuality, as not upside down, as not moving, as not retreating, as not turning, as being like empty space, as without a nature, as having the path of language cut off, as not coming into being, as not coming forth, as not arising, as without a name, as without an appearance, as in reality non-existent, as measureless, as boundless, as unimpeded, and as unobstructed. They exist only because of causes and conditions, and are produced from inversion. Therefore, it is said that constantly delighting in contemplating such characteristics of dharmas is called the second range of association of a bodhisattva. At that time, the well-honored one, wishing to restate his meaning, spoke the following verses. If there is a bodhisattva in the future evil age who with a fearless mind wishes to speak this sutra, he should enter the range of practice and the range of association. He should always stay away from kings as well as princes, great ministers and officials, brutal and dangerous performers, from chandalas along with externalists and brahmacharins. He should not draw near to those of overweening pride who are attached to the small vehicle and study the three stores, nor should he draw near to bhikshus who are breakers of the precepts, arhats in name only, or to bhikshunis who like to play and laugh, those deeply attached to the five desires, or seeking quiescence in the present. Nor should he draw near upasikas, should such people come with good hearts to the bodhisattva to hear of the Buddha way. The bodhisattva then may, without apprehension and without expectations, speak the dharma for them. He should not draw near widows, maidens, or unmanly men, nor should he be familiar with or close to them. He should also not draw near butchers, meat cutters, hunters, or fishermen, or any who killed for profit or sell meat as their livelihood, or those who traffic in female flesh. Such people as these he should not draw near. He should take care never to draw near to those engaged in dangerous, violent sports, nor to actors and performers, or prostitutes and the like. He should not, while in a secluded place, speak the Dharma for women. While speaking the Dharma, he should not joke or laugh. When he enters the city to seek alms, he should go with another bhikshu. Or if there is no other bhikshu, he should single-mindedly recollect the Buddha. Those are what is called the ranges of practice and association. By resort to these two ranges, he can preach in peace and comfort. Further, he does not practice higher, middle, or lower dharmas, nor conditioned or unconditioned dharmas, real or unreal dharmas. He does not distinguish between men and women. He does not obtain any dharma, nor does he know or perceive any. This is what is known as the bodhisattva's range of practice. All the dharmas whatsoever are empty, non-existent, without permanence, neither arising nor extinguished. This is known as the wise one's range of association. It is through inverted discrimination the dharmas exist or not exist, seem real or unreal, created or uncreated. If in a quiet place he cultivates and collects his thoughts, peacefully dwelling unmoved, like Mount Sumeru, contemplating all dharmas as having no existence, like empty space, with nothing firm or solid, uncreated, not coming forth, unmoving, not retreating, dwelling always in one mark. This is called the range of association. If a bhikshu, after my nirvana, enters into this range of practice and range of association, when he speaks this sutra, he will have no fear. When the bodhisattva enters a quiet room and with upright mindfulness, contemplates dharmas in accord with principle, arising from dhyana concentration, he may, for the sake of kings, princes, ministers, brahmins, and such, teach and transform and expound, speaking this sutra with a tranquil mind and without fear. Manjusri, this is called the bodhisattva's peaceful dwelling in the first dharma, and he may, in the future age, speak the Dharma Flower Sutra. Manjusri, after the Tathagata's Nirvana, in the Dharma ending age, if one wishes to speak this sutra, one should dwell in this happily dwelling conduct. Whether one is expounding upon the sutra orally or reading the sutra itself, one should take no delight in speaking of the faults of people or of the sutra, nor should one hold other Dharma masters in contempt, nor speak of the good or bad qualities, the strengths or weaknesses of others. With regard to hearers, one should not mention them by name in order to speak of their faults, nor should one speak of them by name to praise their excellence. One should not harbor resentment or jealousy. Because one skillfully cultivates such peaceful and happy thoughts, he will not oppose his listeners' intentions. If asked difficult questions, he does not answer by resorting to the small vehicle dharma, but uses only the great vehicle for his explanation, which causes his listeners to obtain the wisdom of all modes. At that time, the well-honored one, wishing to restate his meaning, spoke these verses, saying, "The bodhisattva ever delights in tranquility speaking the Dharma. On pure ground, he arranges his seat, smears his body with oil, and washes away dust and filth, wearing fresh, clean clothing, completely pure within and without, seated securely on the Dharma seat. He responds to questions. If there are bhikshus or bhikshunis, upasakas or upasikas, kings, princes, ministers, scholars or commoners, by resorting to the subtle, wonderful principle, with harmonious mien, he speaks for them. If there are difficult questions, he answers in accord with principle. Using causes and conditions and parables, he explains and makes distinctions. Through his use of such expedients, all are moved to bring forth the resolve, which gradually increases as they enter into the Buddha way. Casting out thoughts of laziness and slothful thinking, freeing himself from all worry, he speaks Dharma with a compassionate mind. By day and night he ever speaks the supreme teaching of the way. By means of causes and conditions and limitless analogies, he instructs living beings, leading them to be joyful. Clothing, bedding, food, drink, and medicine, with respect to these, he harbors no expectations. His single focus is to speak the Dharma. According to causal conditions, his wish is to realize the Buddha way and lead living beings to do the same. This, then, is the greatest benefit, the offering of peace and comfort. After my nirvana, if there is a bhikshu who is able to expound upon the wonderful Dharma Flower Sutra, with no thought of envy or anger, with no affliction or obstruction. He will have no worries and no detractors. He also will not fear knives or staffs, nor will he be exiled, because he is secure in his patience. The wise one is thus cultivating well his mind. He is secure in peace and comfort. As I have explained above, this person's merit and virtue cannot be exhaustively described by means of number or parable throughout tens of millions of aeons. Further, Manjusri, in the future ending age, when the Dharma is about to become extinct, the Bodhisattva Mahasattva, who receives, upholds, reads, or recites this sutra, should harbor no thoughts of envy, flattery, or deceit. He should also not ridicule or malign those who study the Buddha way, nor should he seek their strengths or weaknesses. If they are bhikshus, bhikshunis, upasakas, upasikas, those who seek to be hearers, pachika buddhas, or those who seek the bodhisattva way, he should not torment them or cause them to have doubts by saying to them, "You are all very far from the path, and you will never obtain the wisdom of all modes." Why not? Because you are callous and lax in the way. Further, he should not frivolously discuss the Dharma for the sake of argument. He should give rise to thoughts of great compassion towards all living beings, and think of all the Tathagatas as compassionate fathers, all Bodhisattvas as great masters. Always he should deeply revere and pay respect to all the great Bodhisattvas of the Ten Directions. He should speak Dharma in equal measure for all living beings. In accord with Dharma, he should speak neither too much nor too little. Even to those who deeply love the Dharma, he should not speak too much. Manjusri, in the future age, when the Dharma is about to become extinct, it will be impossible to trouble or confuse a Bodhisattva Mahasattva who has accomplished this third happily dwelling conduct when he is speaking the Dharma. He shall gain good fellow students with whom he may read and recite this sutra. Large assemblies will gather to listen to and accept it. Having heard it, they will uphold it. Having upheld it, they'll recite it. Having recited it, they'll be able to speak it. Having spoken it, they'll be able to write it out, to cause others to write it out, to make offerings to it, to revere, honor, and praise it. At that time, the world-honored one, wishing to restate his meaning, spoke verses saying, "If one wishes to speak this sutra, he should rid himself of envy, anger, and arrogance, flattery, and deceitful thoughts. His practice should be honest and straightforward. He should not ridicule others or speak lightly of the Dharma or cause others to have doubts by telling them they shall not obtain Buddhahood. When this son of the Buddha speaks the Dharma, he is ever gentle, agreeable, and patient, compassionate towards all, and never slack in his efforts. The great Bodhisattvas of the Ten Directions take pity on the multitudes and so practice the way. He should bring forth a heart of reverence, thinking, 'These are my great teachers.' With regard to all the Buddhas, world-honored ones, he should think of them as his supreme fathers. He should break through all thoughts of arrogance and then speak the Dharma without obstacle. Such is the third Dharma, which the wise ones should always guard. With single-minded, happily dwelling conduct, one is revered by limitless multitudes. Further, Manjusri, in the future ending age, when the Dharma is about to become extinct, the Bodhisattva Mahasattva who upholds the Dharma Flower Sutra should give rise to thoughts of great kindness for those at home and those to have left home. He should give rise to thoughts of great compassion for those who are not bodhisattvas. He should think, people like this are missing a great deal. Although the Tathagata speaks the Dharma expediently and appropriately, they do not hear, know, or awaken to it. They do not inquire into it, believe it, or understand it. Although these people do not inquire into, believe, or understand this sutra, still when I attain Anuttara Sankhya Sambodhi, wherever they happen to be, I shall use the power of spiritual penetrations and the power of wisdom to lead them to abide within this Dharma. Manjusri, after the Nirvana of the Tathagata, the Bodhisattva Mahasattva, who accomplishes this, the fourth Dharma, shall be free from error when he speaks this Dharma. He will always receive offerings from and be revered, honored, and praised by bhikshus, bhikshunis, upasakas, upasikas, kings, princes, great ministers, common people, brahmans, lay people, and so on. The gods in empty space will always follow and serve him in order to hear the Dharma. If in villages or cities, in the wilds or forests, someone wishing to pose difficult questions approaches him, all the gods, for the sake of the Dharma, will protect him day and night, and he will cause the listeners to be joyful. Why is this? This sutra is protected by the spiritual powers of all the Buddhas of the past, present, and future. Manjusri, throughout limitless kalpas, it is not possible even to hear the name of the Dharma Flower Sutra, much less to see, receive, uphold, read, or recite it. Manjusri, it is like a powerful wheel-turning sage king who wishes to subdue other countries by force. But all the lesser kings do not follow his commands. The wheel-turning king then mobilizes his various troops and goes to punish them. Seeing his troops successful in warfare, he is greatly delighted and rewards them according to their merits, giving them fields, houses, villages, cities, counties, or else clothing, personal ornaments, or various precious treasures of gold, silver, lapis lazuli, mother of pearl, carnelian, coral, or agate, or elephants, horses, carriages, servants, or subjects. Only the bright pearl on his call, that alone he does not give away. Why not? Only the king can wear this pearl on his crown. If he gave it away, the king's retinue would surely be greatly astonished. Manjusri, the Tathagata is also like this. Through the use of the powers of Dhyana Samadhi and wisdom, he has gained the country of the Dharma and is king of the three realms. Still, the demon kings refuse to submit. The Tathagata's generals, the worthy ones and sages, do battle with them. With those who are successful, he is delighted. For the four assemblies, he speaks the sutras, causing their hearts to rejoice. He confers upon them the dhyana concentrations, the liberations, the lack of outflows, the roots and powers, and all the wealth of the Dharma. He further bestows upon them the city of Nirvana, telling them that they have attained cessation. He guides their thoughts, causing them all to rejoice. But he does not speak the Dharma Flower Sutra. Manjusri, eventually, the wheel-turning king, seeing among his troops those who have been greatly successful, is overjoyed and at last gives them the incredible pearl which he has long worn in his topknot and which he would never casually give away. So too is it with the Tathagata. As the great king of the Dharma within the three realms, he uses Dharma to teach and transform all living beings. Seeing the army of worthy ones and sages doing battle with the demons of the five skandhas and the demons of afflictions and the demons of death, and being greatly successful, extinguishing the three poisons, escaping the three realms, and rending the nets of the demons, the Tathagata is greatly pleased. He then speaks to them the Dharma Flower Sutra, which can lead living beings to all wisdom, which meets with resentment and disbelief in all the world, and which he has never spoken of before. Manjushri, the Dharma Flower Sutra, is the foremost among the Tathagata's teachings. Among all the teachings, it is the most profound, and it is only bestowed at the very end, just like that bright pearl which the powerful king long kept and then gave away. Manjushri, the Dharma Flower Sutra, is the secret treasury of all the Buddhas, Tathagatas. Among all the sutras, it is the highest. In the long night of time, it has been guarded and never recklessly expounded. Today, for the first time, I am speaking it for you. At that time, the world on it one, wishing to restate this meaning, spoke verses saying, all is practicing patience and being merciful to all. One will then be able to proclaim the sutra praised by the Buddhas. In the future ending age, one who upholds this sutra should bring forth kindness and compassion for those at home, those who have left home, and those who are not bodhisattvas, thinking those who do not hear or believe this sutra suffer a great loss. When I have gained the Buddha way, I shall use expedience to speak this Dharma for them, so they may abide within it. It is like a powerful wheel-turning king who bestows rewards upon soldiers successful in battle. Elephants, horses, carriages, personal ornaments, as well as fields, houses, villages, cities, and counties, or he may give clothing or various rare treasures, servants or other valuables, giving them joyfully. Should there be a hero who can do difficult deeds, the king will take from his top knot his bright pearl and give it to him. The Tathagata is also thus. As king of all the dharmas, with patience, great power, and a precious store of wisdom, with great kindness and compassion, he transforms the world according to the Dharma. He sees all people suffering pain and agony, seeking liberation and battling with the demons. For these living beings, he speaks various dharmas. Using great expedience, he teaches them the sutras. Once he knows that living beings have become strong, then at the very end, he speaks the Dharma flower for them. This is like the king who unties his top knot and gives away his bright pearl. Highest among the hosts of sutras, this sutra is venerable. I always guard and protect it and never speak it recklessly. But now the time is exactly right to speak it for all of you. After my extinction, those who seek the Buddha way, who wish to gain peace and ease, and to proclaim this sutra, should draw near such dharmas as these four. Those who read this sutra will have no worries or afflictions, will be free from the pain of sickness, with a countenance fresh and clear. They won't be born poor, lowly, or ugly. Living beings will be happy to see them, as if they were longed for sages. All the children of the gods will act as their messengers. Knives and staffs will not hurt them. Poison will not harm them. And should someone revile them, his mouth will be stopped. They shall roam fearlessly like the Lion King. The light of their wisdom will shine like the sun. In dreams they will see only wonderful things. They may see the Tathagatas seated on the lion thrones, surrounded by a host of bhikshus, as they speak the Dharma. They will also see the dragons, spirits, asuras, and so forth, in number like the Ganges sands, reverent with palms joined. They will see themselves appearing to speak the Dharma for them. Further, they will see all the Buddhas, their bodies of golden hue, emitting limitless light, illumining all, and proclaiming all the Dharmas with the Brahma sound. The Buddhas, for the fourfold host, will speak the supreme Dharma. They shall see themselves there too, with palms joined, praising the Buddhas. Hearing the Dharma, they will rejoice and make offerings. They will gain the Dharanis and certify to non-retreating wisdom. The Buddhas, knowing their minds, have deeply entered the Buddha way, will then bestow upon them a prediction for the realization of the most proper enlightenment, saying, "You good men shall in the future age attain limitless wisdom and the great way of the Buddha. Your lands shall be adorned and pure, vast and incomparable, and the four assemblies there will listen to the Dharma with palms joined." They will also see themselves dwelling in the mountain forests, practicing wholesome dharmas, certifying to the real mark, deeply entering dhyana concentration, and seeing the Buddhas of the ten directions. The Buddhas with golden bodies will be adorned with the marks of 100 blessings. Hearing the Dharma, they'll speak it to others and always have good dreams like these. They'll also dream of being a king who forsakes his palace and retinue, as well as fine objects of the five desires, to enter a Bodhimanda. There beneath the Bodhi tree, they sit upon the lion throne, seeking the way for 7 days and gaining the Buddhist wisdom. After realizing the supreme way, they rise and turn the Dharma wheel and speak the Dharma for the fourfold host. Throughout thousands of myriads of millions of aeons, they speak the non-outflow wondrous Dharma and save limitless living beings. Later, they enter Nirvana, as a lamb goes out when its fuel is gone. If in the future evil age they can speak this foremost Dharma, they shall gain great benefit, merit, and virtue, as told above.